Hey guys, welcome back to my channel.
Hey guys, welcome back.
Hey guys, it's Bella. Welcome back to my channel. I hope you're all having an incredible day today. So today we're going to be talking about part two of the Girlie Chu Holzenkopf case. And if you haven't seen part one, I will link it down below. It's wild. So make sure you check it out. It basically gives you all the background information on the case, the relationship between Girlie and Diazian, and just how crazy and ridiculous Diazian is. All of his schemes, his lies, all of that kind of stuff. We ended part one just as Diazian met a woman named Linda Henning. So I'm gonna go ahead and pick right up off from there. So Linda Henning was born on the 10th of October in 1953 in Hollywood, California. In 1999, she was engaged to this guy named Steve Zachary, and she kind of dabbled in conspiracy theories, aliens, UFOs, the end times, lizard people, that sort of thing. And she even attended these like UFO meetings. Diazian and Linda actually met at the University of New Mexico at a David Icke conference on UFOs. I mean, based on how they met, I feel like you kind of get an insight as to how the relationship is gonna go. Diazian told her all of the usual stuff, all of the usual lies, that he was dying of leukemia, that sort of thing. He told her about his serums that could cure illnesses and reverse aging.
Oh, did you?
It was off your head.
Oh, you had it on your foot.
I had it under my foot, but then once when I was up in midair.
So did he. Area.
Any words of advice for the folks at home?
Yes. This is Dr. Holzenkopf speaking to you about the Caribbean. It is a wonderful, wonderful place. Bring your friends. Just when a beautiful girl goes by, then there it goes.
Dr. H has a medical abnormality, an anomaly of science. When he sees a beautiful woman, his left clavicle becomes intensely excited.
Anyway, they hit it off hard and fast. She dumped her fiance, got with Diazian, and they were engaged within 2 weeks of meeting. When she met Diazian, she only sort of had a passing interest in UFOs and aliens and lizard people and that sort of thing, but after meeting him, it kind of became like a full-blown obsession. She started bringing him along to her UFO meetings, and everyone at the UFO club kind of said, once he started coming to the meetings, her personality just completely changed and she was like really obsessed with him.
In 1999, New Mexico artist and entrepreneur Linda Henning had a life that most would envy.
I sold my clothing line in Europe, Australia, Canada.
She was tall, attractive, always dressed nice, expensive clothes. Perfect hair, perfect makeup, nails, you know, the whole thing.
But that would suddenly change when she met a 34-year-old man named Diazian Holzenkopf. And seemingly overnight, 45-year-old Linda Henning's picture-perfect life changed.
She changed so dramatically, so quickly.
Diazian brought some crazy stories with him to these UFO meetings. He told them all that he was a 10,000-year-old alien and a doctor of genetics, and that aliens were going to attack the world, that they were going to kill most of the world's population by poisoning the drinking water, and only a select few people would survive, people that were living within certain vortexes. He told them about his credentials, of course, the fact that he had leukemia and was dying of leukemia. He told them that he was part of the CIA and had killed tens of thousands of people in third world countries. He talked about the fact that the world was run by these aliens who had come to Earth tens of thousands of years ago, and they were like shape-shifting aliens, so they were like actually lizards, but they could shape-shift to look like humans. And they were who was running the world. And they were like, you know, government officials and authorities and stuff. And he said that in 2007, these government officials were going to destroy 2/3 of the world's population, as you do. Everyone from the group besides Linda basically thought he was full of it. And I mean, how whack do you have to be to have a group of conspiracy theorists from a UFO group thinking you're whack? Anytime somebody from the group questioned Diazian, his credentials, his stories, anything that he said, he and Linda would get really defensive. Like for example, he claimed that he could predict the future, and that's how he knew that the government was gonna wipe out 2/3 of the population in 2007. So they would ask him like, okay, predict something that's gonna happen in the next hour. hour. Predict something that's going to happen in the next day. And, you know, he and Linda would tell them, like, you just don't get it. They also asked to see his ID and his credentials because, you know, he had a lot of ridiculous credentials that he told people that he had. And every single week, week after week, he would be like, oh, I forgot my ID. Oh, I forgot my ID. Oh, I forgot it again. How do I keep doing that? Silly me. One time, a friend of Linda's hired a private investigator to look into Diazian because, you know, her ex-fiance, her friends, her family were all worried about her. Within 2 weeks, she left her fiance, which, might I add, Diazian and his friend Bill Miller came in and physically removed her fiance from their house. But she left her fiance, she got engaged to this new guy within 2 weeks, her personality had completely changed, and she was becoming really obsessed with all of these crazy conspiracy theories. So of course, they were worried about her. This private investigator found out all of his lies, his real name, his fake credentials, all of that sort of thing. They told Linda, she didn't believe it and she didn't care. While all of this is happening, Diazian is also trying to get rid of Dimitri. I mean, he never really cared for him anyway. Even before he met Julie and started palming Dimitri off to Julie, he had these two elderly neighbors. So Pedro and his wife and another elderly neighbor. And he would drop Dimitri off to Pedro and his wife 5 days a week, all day, until she finally said, you need to look after your child. And so he took Dimitri and then started dropping him off at another elderly neighbor's 5 days a week, all day long. So after Diazian went to Julie's and took Dimitri back, he went to see an adoption agent named Vonda Cheshire, and she had never seen a case quite like this one. Originally, Diazian had provided a birth certificate from New Mexico that stated that he and Gurley were the biological parents, but he couldn't provide any documentation from when Gurley was pregnant, and he also couldn't provide any documentation from when Dimitri was a newborn baby until he was 1 month old. There was nothing from that time period. Vonda obviously questioned him about this, and he was like, okay, like, Gurley is not the biological mother. I am the biological father, but the biological mother is this Asian woman who has provided an egg. He said that he fertilized the egg and grew the baby in a lab. He also told her that he had leukemia, but the medical examination that was required for an adoption showed that he didn't have leukemia or any other illnesses for that matter. But anyway, Diazian did end up handing Dimitri off to his new family on the 27th of August in 1999. He took a group photo with the family, and that was that. That same day, though, that Dimitri was handed off to his new adoptive family, Vonda actually called the FBI because she was so worried about the whole situation. Sergeant Edward Aid was dispatched to Diazian's house to do a welfare check because I think that they were worried that he was going to harm himself because his wife had left him, he was going through a divorce, and he didn't seem right, as I'm sure you can imagine. He still had guns in the house, so he agreed to hand the guns over to a neighbor to look after them for a while. Sergeant Aid actually asked him where his wife was, and without any hesitation, Diazian said, she's dead. So now we're back up to speed with Gurley's disappearance. On the afternoon of the 9th of September in 1999, Gurley finishes up work. On her way home, she mails a letter to her parents and then she heads home to her apartment. At 7:03 p.m., she called her phone company because she hadn't received her phone bill yet and she was confused as to why. And then just a few minutes later, Ernie called her and Gurley did not answer the phone. And over the next couple of hours until 10 p.m, Ernie called her a couple of times and still Gurley didn't answer a single call. The next morning, Ernie tried calling Gurley again, but again, Gurley never answered the phone. As I mentioned, on the 10th of September, she didn't show up for work that day. Ernie called into her work asking if she'd seen her, if they'd heard from her, if she'd showed up for work. And then by 8:15 a.m., Kathy Szymanski, Gurley's boss, called 911. Gurley's co-worker, Jesse Grove, as I mentioned, had also gone to her apartment to check out what was going on. He gets to the apartment shortly after 8:30 and he finds that Gurley's car is still there. He went and rang the doorbell and knocked on her apartment door, but nobody answered, and he also said that it was like eerily quiet. He tried to open the door, but it was locked, and then he went and had like a little look inside her car windows and everything seemed to be normal. So he decides to go and talk to the building manager, Bill Orth, to try and get him to let him in. Bill lets him in, and when they get in, they notice that the deadbolt wasn't locked, which was extremely unusual for Gurley because she was terrified of Diazian and she always had that deadbolt locked. When they get inside the apartment, nobody's there. Everything looks relatively normal, except on the orange carpet, there are these three big stains, which just looks like somebody had spilled something, maybe tried to clean something up. But other than that, it looked super normal. Because Kathy had already called the police and they agreed to do a welfare check, Officer Tim Portwine was already on his way to the apartment block. He got there, he spoke to the building manager, Bill Orth, and Bill was like, you know, we already had a look in the apartment, everything looks relatively normal. And so Tim Portwine was like, okay, I won't bother having a look myself, I'm just going to go and visit Diazian's house and check on him, see what's going on there. He met Sergeant Aide there because Sergeant Aide was actually on a separate call to Diazian's house, and the front door was open, it was unlocked, and when they entered the house, everything was completely empty. There was no furniture, papers, dishes, nothing. So they questioned some neighbors. They went and questioned the neighbor who was looking after Diazian's guns for him, and he said that he had given them back a few days before, and that a couple of days ago there had been a moving truck there who packed up all of Diazian's stuff because he was moving to El Paso so that he could easily transfer from El Paso to Mexico where he was getting his cancer treatments, which, you know, wasn't the case, obviously. That was just the story he'd given his neighbor. Diazian had actually gone to South Carolina with another one of his fiancés. So by this point, he's got like three fiancés while still technically being married to Gurley. So this fiancé, Sherry Clinton, flew in from South Carolina, and the day after Gurley disappeared, on the 10th of September 1999, they drove and moved to South Carolina together. Sherry actually said that he was really bizarre. So the night before, on the 9th of September, Sherry had flown into Albuquerque from South Carolina so that her and Diazian could move to South Carolina together, and it was the first time that they'd ever met. On their drive to South Carolina, he was like injecting himself in the arms with needles, and she was like, you know, what is that? And he was like, it's morphine for my cancer. And if he didn't take it, he would start just like shaking uncontrollably. He also took another medicine, which was a white powder, which he put underneath his tongue to help it take effectiveness sooner. And he was also vomiting blood. So at this point, they decide to go and check out Gurley's apartment for themselves because obviously they've been trained to know what to look for more so than just like regular civilians. As soon as they enter the apartment, they notice the smell of bleach. The three large stains that Jesse and Bill had seen in the apartment that they just thought looked like wet spots, they noticed actually had a bit of a reddish tint to them. Other than that, there were no signs of a struggle and the house was otherwise tidy. They ended up getting a whole team into the apartment to search it, to test it for DNA. They tested those big large stains on the carpet and found that they were in fact blood that someone had tried their hardest to clean up. They also did a luminol test in the apartment and the place just lit up. There was lots of little specks of blood everywhere, so they ripped up the entire carpet and sent the whole thing off for testing. Before they can even start comparing DNA and running tests though, they get another big lead. Someone driving along a remote highway about 200 kilometers away in Magdalena made a disturbing discovery. Just a few hours after Gurley's co-workers reported her missing, at around 10:30 a.m., a state highway employee was driving down Highway 60 to do his weekly job of picking up rubbish at like local rest areas. That's when he sees on the side of the highway a tarp, and he gets out to pick it up because, you know, it's like a hazard. It could blow onto the road, it could blow onto someone's windscreen. It's just not very safe to leave it there. That's really all he's thinking at this point though, because it's hunting season, people often use these tarps for deer and all sorts of things. It's not really anything crazy. He notices some blood on the tarp, but again, doesn't think much of it because he thinks it could just be deer blood, that this is a tarp that somebody used to wrap up their deer or their elk. But then he notices some duct tape with some hair stuck to it, and he also notices some duct tape that's like wrapped in like a figure eight, like kind of what you would use to tie somebody up. Then a few meters away from that, he finds a girl's top, underwear, and shorts, and they have dried blood on them. He picked it all up and took it into town and handed it directly to the police. So co-workers and friends are telling police, you have to look into Diazian. If anyone had something to do with it, it's him. She's terrified of him. He's a nut job. And so police are trying to get in contact with him. He is their number one suspect at this point. While searching around Gurley's apartment, they found some adoption papers and they had the emergency signature on it from Linda Henning. So they're like, okay, let's contact Linda Henning. She sits and speaks with them and she just claims she knows nothing. She doesn't even know who Gurley is. And I guess after that, she goes into hiding because police have a lot of trouble getting in contact with her after that. You know, she tries to pretend like she's gonna be all cooperative and speak with them, and they speak with her, and everything on her side is a complete lie, and then after that she's like, peace. They also try and get in contact with neighbors to see if they had seen anything funny going on, and they get in contact with one neighbor named Curry Wythe, and she said that she had seen him on the 9th of September 1999, the day that Gurley had gone missing. She said that at around 7 p.m. she and her friend were sitting on her balcony when a car comes racing down the street pretty urgently and parks across Diazian's driveway. Like, they've just zoomed in there, parked on a complete angle, stopped the car. Diazian gets out of the car and he is completely black. Black arms, face, legs, everywhere that you can see him, he's black. He quickly went into his house and 5 minutes later, he comes out, gets back into the car, and the car zips off back down the street. 3 days later, on the 13th of September, police get 3 calls from 3 different women saying that Diazian has been threatening them. And one of them came from Diazian's divorce lawyer. And let me tell you a little bit about her, because this is also another crazy part of this story. So his divorce attorney and his divorce from Gurley was Felissa Garcia. On the 5th of February 1999, she agreed to represent him. And then by the 27th of April, just a couple of months later, Diazian has named her the second beneficiary of his will after Dimitri, who was the first beneficiary of his will. And then that same month, Felissa was going to adopt Dimitri. She even secured an attorney to represent her in the matter. And the craziest thing about all of this is that Gurley had a life insurance policy of $50,000 and Dimitri was the beneficiary of that. And then just a couple of days after that, on the 4th of May, her mother-in-law sent a check for $1,000 to Diazian toward the purchase of his house, because her mother-in-law was going to purchase his house. It's crazy. So like, his attorney was going to adopt his son Dimitri. She was named the second beneficiary of his will after Dimitri, his son, and her mother-in-law was going to purchase Diazian's house. So anyway, 3 women call the police to report these threatening phone calls, one of whom is his attorney, Felissa, and she says he screamed at her on the phone for like 20 minutes and said that he believes his son had been dissected and he demanded proof that he was okay. He then said to her, like, if you don't get me some evidence that he is alive, you're all gonna die. The other 2 women to get threatening phone calls was his neighbor Kari, who had seen him get out fully black, and also Vonda Cheshire, the adoption agent that he had used to adopt Dimitri out. But through these threatening phone calls, police were able to track him down. They traced the calls to a residence in South Carolina, which is where they were finally able to get a hold of Diazian. He was there with his new fiance, and thanks to these calls as well, they were able to arrest him on the 22nd of September under 3 counts of making threatening calls across state lines, which is at least enough to hold him while they try and get some more evidence against him in the case of Gurley's disappearance. So with him under arrest, they go and do a search of the house he was staying in with his new fiance in South Carolina. They find a gun, 2 vials of blood, a bunch of different medications, needles, glass vials, and they also find Gurley's address book and her ID. They also find a steam cleaner, like the one that would have been used to clean the carpet in Gurley's apartment, and they also found 2 sticks of charcoal, which is what could have been used to paint himself completely black. With the evidence mounting against him, they convene a grand jury in Albuquerque in the hopes of indicting him in Gurley's murder. And the grand jury trial begins on the 27th of September in 1999, and their star witness is no other than Linda Henning. Didn't really help them for a star witness. Like, she was acting really weird. She was avoiding all of their questions about Gurley and her disappearance and still claiming like she didn't know her. Even though police had evidence that she had gone into Gurley's branch of the Bank of America, she had literally been served by Gurley, who had like a plaque on her desk with her name Gurley Hossenkopf on it. And like, I feel like that's a pretty obscure last name. So even if she went in there not knowing who Gurley was, which I highly doubt, as if you wouldn't put 2 and 2 together after seeing that last name. While the trial is going on, police are still trying to gather more evidence to get a more concrete case, because at this point, all they have is some circumstantial evidence at best. They find out that this guy named Bill Miller might be involved and that he's been hanging around a lot with Linda and Diazian. They start looking into this guy, and the more they look into him, the more sketchy everything gets. They interviewed members of the UFO club, and apparently Bill went to the UFO club with Diazian and Linda, and he would always say really weird stuff, like about the fact that Diazian had hired him and Linda to help get rid of Gurley.
He said to me that he talked about that, you know, he had more information and that he knew where the crime scene or the murder scene was and that he knew where the body was.
Police also find out that Bill Miller went elk hunting for 2 days at around the time of Gurley's disappearance. So they go and interview Bill himself, and he says, yeah, Diazian tried to recruit me and Linda to kill his wife. He's like, obviously I had nothing to do with it, but they didn't buy that, of course. So they get a search warrant to search his house, and they find some pretty damning evidence. Okay, so they found a notebook in his truck, and this is what it said in it. The pituitary gland and the pineal gland had a strong drug in it, like heroin and endorphins, need terrorization for it to be put in blood, whatever that means. They also find out that he owns a hunting cabin in Magdalena, which is where Gurley's bloody clothes and that tarp were found. They also found that he had opened a safety deposit box the day Gurley had disappeared using a different name and address in Colorado. And inside this safety deposit box, police find $10,000 in cash. It's like separated into four little wads, and all of these wads are wrapped in alfoil. And they also find $12,000 worth of coins. I think some of them were like rare coins or something. On the 29th of September, Bill appears in front of the grand jury in Diazian's grand jury trial, and he claims that on two occasions, Diazian came to him and asked him to kill Gurley, and that on a third occasion, he asked both him and Linda Henning to bring Gurley to him. But by this point, they really only have circumstantial evidence against all three of them, against Bill, Linda, and Diazian. But then on the 21st of October, 6 weeks after Gurley's disappearance, police get the results of the forensic testing taken out on the carpet in Gurley's apartment, as well as the clothes that were found in Magdalena. The blood on the tarp, the blouse, the underwear, and the shorts found in Magdalena, as well as the hair from the duct tape found there as well, were all a match to Gurley. The tiny droplets of blood that were found around in the carpet of Gurley's apartment were a match to Linda Henning. They also find hair and saliva on Gurley's clothes and on the carpet in her apartment that are a match to Diazian. And they also found like a bunch of animal hairs and stuff on her carpet. So let me read you what they found. 17 natural deer hairs, 7 dyed deer hairs, 57 cat hairs, 1 natural rabbit hair, 5 dyed rabbit hairs, 15 dog hairs, 2 natural feathers, and 1 pink feather. Keeping in mind, Gurley had never owned a cat in that apartment, but you know who does own cats? Linda, she owns 6. And you know who else owns cats? Bill, he owns 2. On Gurley's blouse found in Magdalena, they also found 56 cat hairs and 1 dog hair. On the tarp, they found 101 cat hairs, 5 dog hairs, 2 dyed rabbit hairs, and 2 green feathers. Then on the 29th of October, they carry out another search warrant at Bill's apartment looking specifically for animal hairs and feathers. They found he had used pink colored deer hairs and bright colored feathers to make like a fishing line bait or something. In his garage, they also found deer pelts, pink deer hairs, and green feathers. And of course, like a bunch of cat hairs because he had 2 cats. They send all of this away for testing, including some of his cat's hair, and they were a match for the fibers that were found in Gurley's apartment and on her clothes. Also in Gurley's carpet, they found glitter and this like arts and crafts sand, both of which they were able to connect to Linda Henning. They found that the steam cleaner that was found with Diazian in South Carolina had a bunch of like animal hairs, deer hairs, feathers, cat hairs, rabbit fur, you know, all of that sort of thing that was found on Gurley's clothes, the tarp, the carpet. So with all of this, on the 17th of November, the grand jury indicted Diazian and Linda Henning for murder, kidnapping, and various other charges. Bill Miller was not yet indicted at this point because they felt that they didn't have enough evidence to convict him. While awaiting trial in prison, police got some more interesting info about Diazian from other people that were being held with him. His cellmate said Diazian had told him he was too clever to be convicted of a crime and that he had committed the perfect crime. He also said that he and Linda were going to kill every single person on earth except those with A negative blood type, and he was going to kill them by poisoning the drinking water of the world. Another informant said that Diazian had told him that Diazian, Bill, and Linda had all killed Gurley over money and that nobody would find the body because they had dissolved it with acid. There were also informants coming forward about Linda who were staying in prison with Linda as well, and one of these informants said that Linda had confessed to Gurley's murder. Apparently, Linda told this person, girly as food, good spaghetti sauce, they won't find her, and the little bitch got what she deserved. This informant also claimed that Miller knew what was happening, that he had carried Girly into a chair, into a house, and they had mats on the floor so that there was no evidence left around and she didn't bleed on the floor and it was an easy cleanup.
The witness is Bill Miller's psychic, Cynthia Hess. Hess says Moya contacted her 3 weeks ago and stated that he knows where Girly is buried.
That he knew where the murder scene or the crime scene was, and also that he knew where Girly Hasenkopf was buried. But they were not going to say anything to anybody for 3 years.
In 3 years, the statute of limitations expires on Miller's charges.
Apparently, Henning had also mentioned that Girly was kicking and screaming as they brought her in. Diazian was also allegedly there, and he apparently stuffed something in Girly's mouth to prevent her from making any noise. A fourth informant came forward. This was also another inmate with Linda Henning. So this informant said Linda had written letters that were coded in poetry. She also said that she and Diazian had killed Girly, and she was glad that they did. Allegedly, she also said that Girly's body and her clothes were disposed of in 2 separate locations, but her body wasn't far from where her clothes were found or disposed of. Linda also claimed that she was an alien queen and that she fought Girly and that she had to kill Girly for insurance purposes.
Linda Henning wanted to became a queen in her mind, and she perceived a great threat to planet Earth and that she would have to fight other queens. And the evidence, the paperwork in this case suggests that Girly was that threat. She had been convinced that Girly was that threat, that she would have to be killed.
Girly Chu was an alien queen, and I must defeat her.
Police ended up doing this huge search for Girly. It spanned over 100 miles. It used airplanes, helicopters, horses, dogs, thousands of dollars in police overtime and resources and heaps of volunteers. But despite their efforts, Girly's body has never been found. And then by January of 2000, before Diazian's trial even started, he decided to change his plea to guilty. I guess he knew how much evidence they had against him despite not having the body. I mean, they had blood and saliva that linked both Diazian and Linda to the crime scene, not to mention all of the animal hairs and fibers that were found. They knew Linda purchased a tarp from Home Depot right before Girly went missing. They found 2 guns and a ninja sword at Linda's home, and they actually found Diazian's blood on the handle of the ninja sword, but the blood that was on the actual blade was too compromised to be able to test. It was a pretty solid case. So he pleads guilty to avoid the death penalty, and he says he wants to make a plea deal, that he'll tell them everything that happened on the 9th of September 1999, the day Girly was murdered, in exchange for a life sentence served in Wyoming. In his confession, he basically says that Bill Miller and his militia agreed to kidnap Girly from her apartment and kill her elsewhere, and Diazian would then go to her apartment and clean everything up, get rid of any signs of foul play. He apparently told her that Girly was not to be injured in the apartment because it would make his job of cleaning it up a lot harder. He said he never offered Miller any money or diamonds in exchange, that Bill Miller said that he did it because him and his militia needed the practice. And he also said that by late August, Miller had put this plan into action. Miller told Diazian during one of the UFO meetings that he had started making nightly visits to Tony's compound, which is what he referred to it as, and it was basically just a construction site on the Rio Grande, and Diazian claims he had actually taken him there to see it one time, but Diazian didn't remember where it was. Apparently, he planned to put Girly's body into concrete and store it at Tony's compound. He said Miller found out where Girly lived by following her home from work. So he claims the actual crime began at 1 p.m. on the 9th of September 1999. One of Miller's friends staked out the bank Girly's working at, and another one of the friends waited the apartment. Diazian spent the afternoon with Linda, and he also spent it packing for his move to South Carolina. And apparently Diazian had learned that there was no security at Girly's complex until 9 p.m. Everything was carefully planned around this, and the kidnapping apparently took place between 5:15 and 6 p.m. He claims that Linda was his alibi, so he needed her to believe he was there all night, he needed her to be able to say, yep, he never left my sight, he was at my house all night. So he says to her, hey, I'm feeling a little shaky, can you go and get my medicine from Walgreens? And he knew Walgreens wasn't close by, and it was gonna take her about an hour to get there, get the medicine, and come back. So Linda leaves, he goes to Gurley's apartment, and he knows he has about 45 minutes to clean everything up before he needs to head back to meet Linda before she gets back to her house. When he got to Gurley's apartment, he found that a lamp had been turned over onto its side, there was papers scattered everywhere, and there were clumps of hair and blood all over the carpet. So he cleans it all up as quickly as possible, but because there's blood, it's gonna take longer, he doesn't have the time, so before heading back to Linda's, he quickly makes a little detour to his own house, which is where he knows he has some hyaluronic acid and some vials of female blood. It was at this time that his neighbor saw him fully black, his arms, face, legs, everything black, and he claims that he wasn't actually black, that he was just really dirty from cleaning. You know, as you do, you just become covered in completely black stuff when you clean. He then apparently rushed back to Linda's, got there between 7 and 7:05, just a few minutes before Linda got home. He took some of the medicine she got him, and then he needed to get her out of the house again because he needed to go back to Gurley's apartment to finish off cleaning and deal with the blood. So they had been doing some renovations at Linda's house in one of the bathrooms, and he said, "I need you to go get me some tile spaces so I can deal with the tile situation in the bathroom from our renovations." He took some of the medicine that she'd bought him at Walgreens, and then he needed to get rid of her again because he needed to go and deal with the blood at Gurley's apartment. And they had been doing some renovations at Linda's house in one of the bathrooms, I think, and like redoing the tiling. So he goes, "I need you to go and get me some spaces for the tiles." So she goes down to get the spaces, he grabs his blood vials and his hyaluronic acid, and he goes to go to Gurley's apartment, but as he gets in the car, the blood vial breaks in his pocket. And apparently the only other vial of blood he has is Linda Henning's blood. So he had no choice but to use that. So he goes back in, he quickly grabs Linda's blood, and he goes to Gurley's apartment. It was now around 10 p.m, so the security was going to be there, so he parked down the road and he jumped the fence into the complex. He then went into the apartment, diluted Linda's blood into the hyaluronic acid, and then placed it around the apartment, on the couch, in the carpet, and that is apparently why they found Linda's blood in the apartment. He said that he had done about a 1 to 1,000 dilution of blood in the acid, so it was meant to be so degraded by the time police tested it that they wouldn't be able to get a match, which obviously didn't happen. He also said that he knew Bill killed her, but he didn't know how he did it.
"Society views murder as the most heinous crime known to mankind. But when you decide you're going to commit murder, you decide that you're going to trade your life for theirs. I did that."
"She knew that you were looking for her, and she knew..."
She knew she was going to be hunted like the dog she was. And yes, she knew, like a scared rabbit in an open field, she knew."
I mean, investigators weren't buying that was the real story for a few reasons. Firstly, he said the abduction happened between 5:15 and 6 p.m, which we know isn't the case because Gurley made a call to her phone company at 7:03 p.m. Secondly, he said the only vial of blood that he had left was Linda Henning's blood after the first one broke, which just wasn't true because in their investigations, police found that he had multiple, including other female blood, one labeled Samantha. But in exchange for his plea bargain, he was sentenced to a life sentence plus 61 years to be served in Wyoming State Penitentiary. Then on the 24th of May in 2002, a second grand jury was convened in order to indict Bill Miller. The star witness against Miller was Diazian, but this backfired big time. He was a massive douchebag to the jurors. There was actually one juror that he singled out and was so racist to her that she didn't come back the next day. Bill Miller was eventually indicted by a grand jury, and his trial was in the summer of 2003, but he was only convicted of evidence tampering and was sentenced to time served with 1 year probation. On the 1st of October in 2002, Linda Henning's trial began.
"I've just waited 3 years to go to trial, and now I have my chance. And I was tired of being tried by the press, and now it's time for us to fight back. That's what a trial is all about."
"Anything about aliens in all of this?"
"Oh, I'm sure there'll be an alien or two on the witness stand."
"Alright, thanks a lot."
We'll try to keep the aliens out of the jurors."
"Okay. Thank you."
Diazian actually testified in her defense and said that he was the mastermind behind the whole thing, that she had nothing to do with it, and he and Bill Miller killed Gurley. The trial only lasted 25 days and ended on the 25th of October. The jury found her guilty of a felony murder charge, kidnapping, conspiracy to commit kidnapping, 3 counts of perjury, criminal solicitation to commit perjury, 2 counts of tampering with evidence, and 2 counts of conspiracy to tamper with evidence. And on the 18th of April 2003, she was sentenced to 73 years in prison.
I think the whole thing has been a hoax from day one.
Linda Henning thinks there is more to her murder conviction than meets the eye.
Now, I have been painted as the biggest monster, the most dangerous criminal in New Mexico history. Now, you've got to look at my background and say, well, where is it? There must be something that they're afraid that I'm going to say, because they've made every effort possible to silence me.
Well, of course, I know what they don't want me to say.
Which is?
Which I'm not going to say. I'm still alive, so it's probably because I've kept my mouth shut.
I will only say that everybody's in for a real big surprise. Mm-hmm. The empire consumes all. The strong survive and the weak perish. That's about everything you need to know. I'm innocent, and I believe that the evidence will prove itself. It's there. It's in discovery. If I can just get somebody to, you know, bring it out. Let's bring it out in court.
As of last year, Diazian actually tried to have his sentence vacated.
Now, 18 years later, Hasenkopf is asking a judge to vacate his sentence. More than 400 pages, he makes many, many claims and provides pages and pages of interviews and evidence. The biggest, that his sentence was illegal. He was denied due process because of collusion, his attorneys failed at their jobs, and he was forced into his plea deal. Hasenkopf claimed prosecutors were colluding with Albuquerque police to hide evidence that would have exonerated him and his mistress, Linda Henning.
The judge on the case granted his attorney 6 months to get all of his information in order, but I couldn't find anything else. I don't know what happened after that 6 months because I couldn't find any information on it.
And you absolutely feel that you need 6 months?
I do, Your Honor. This investigation, I don't want to get into too many details, but this case involves global connections.
But I'll definitely make sure to keep you guys updated if there are any new developments in the case. But that is the end of this crazy roller coaster of a case. I really hope it wasn't too confusing. I tried my best to like keep it in an order that would make sense because the case is really just so all over the place. I really hope his sentence doesn't get vacated, and I really highly doubt that it will after everything that happened and all the evidence that they have against him. But you know, he's gonna try and lie his way out of it, probably like he tried to lie his way through life. This guy was just the biggest con artist ever. I can't even believe it. Like, when I was reading this story, I was just like, what the hell? How are there people like this in the world? I would love to know your thoughts in the comments down below and have a little chat about what you think. And I hope you guys have an incredible rest of your day. Hopefully I will see you in my next video. Bye guys!